Good morning and welcome to the fourth meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2021. This morning we're meeting in hybrid format for our final evidence session on the alternative certification model. And joining us today on behalf of the Scottish Qualifications Authority are Fiona Robertson, Chief Executive, Dr. Jill Stewart, Director of Qualifications Development, and Beth Black, who's Director of Policy Analysis and Standards. And I'd very much like to welcome you all to Parliament today and to our committee. I understand that Fiona intends to make a brief opening statement on behalf of the SQA, and then we'll get into the questions.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning. So thank you for the opportunity to appear before the committee this morning to reflect on the experience of delivering the alternative certification model, the ACM, in 2021, as well as looking ahead. It goes without saying, but bears repeating, that the ACM was developed and delivered in the context of a global pandemic for which there was no script. The whole education system came together through the National Qualifications 2021 group to design and implement the ACM with clear roles and responsibilities, and worked incredibly hard to deliver for Scotland's learners and to ensure credibility and fairness remained at the heart of our qualification system. This was not straightforward, and nor should it have been, given what was at stake, but I'm proud of the way that learners, parents, schools, colleges, professional associations and local authorities collaborated in the most exceptional of circumstances. That pride extends to my colleagues across SQA who are passionate about doing their work and doing their very best for learners, and who over the past year have worked very hard to deliver. Tough choices had to be made at times, but the NQ group were clear that the ACM was the best possible approach when we were faced with a situation that was rapidly evolving before us in real time. On 9th of August, almost 137,000 learners across Scotland received SQA qualifications, and they can be proud of their achievements and have full confidence in the results. The experience of the ACM in 2021 has helped us develop our approach this coming year, following the announcement by ministers in August of a return to exams should it be safe to do so. We have announced contingency plans which have been developed in collaboration with partners from across the education system and have been clearly communicated, with messages and materials shaped by advice from those partners. An NQ 2022 group will continue to be a feature of this year. We will continue to keep learners, parents, carers, schools and colleges updated as further information becomes available, but we've been clear that learners will not be expected to undertake dual assessment, thus avoiding any increase in workload and stress. Ministers remain very supportive of the work that we do, but they have considered that the time is right to look at the national organisations supporting and serving the education system in line with the OECD's findings on the alignment between a curriculum and assessment. We will play a full and positive role in the review process which is underway, reflecting the skills, knowledge and experience of colleagues across SQA, whilst continuing to deliver for thousands of learners during the transition period. In terms of the future, I welcome the most recent OECD report by Gordon Stobart on assessment and qualifications. The pandemic and the alternative assessment models that have been used in the absence of exams have shone a light on these issues, and it is imperative that we learn from this experience and from the lessons of recent reforms. I sincerely hope that everyone, including members of this Parliament and this committee, positively engage in this debate and get behind Scotland's future approach to assessment and qualifications and the organisation that will be tasked with delivery. With my colleagues, I'm very happy to answer questions this morning. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Fiona, for your opening statement. You already alluded to this, so let me ask you this first question. In June, the Cabinet Secretary announced effectively the abolition of the SQA. Can I ask you why you understand the SQA is to be abolished?
Well, on June the 21st, the OECD report on Curriculum for Excellence was published, and at the same time the Cabinet Secretary announced it was an intention to accept the recommendations of the OECD report, including the suggestion that there was a curriculum and an assessment agency was established. And it was on that basis that the Cabinet Secretary intimated that the SQA should be replaced. And of course, there's a review process to consider these issues in more detail now underway, with the appointment of Ken Muir, former Chief Executive of the General Teaching Council for Scotland, acting as professional advisor to a review which is being undertaken by government. And that review is obviously now underway, and we are discussing those issues both with Ken and with government colleagues on an ongoing basis.
But where has the SQA failed to live up to its purpose such that it needs the recommendation, the decision of the government is to abolish the SQA? Where has it failed to live up to its purpose?
Well, I think what the Cabinet Secretary... I don't think the Cabinet Secretary has said that the SQA has failed to live up to its purpose. I think what the Cabinet Secretary has said is that that she wishes to consider a new organisation with a new purpose. Now, as part of that, I would sincerely hope that there's some continuity of function around assessment and qualifications, and the role that the SQA plays, and in particular the role that colleagues with the skills, expertise and experience play within the SQA. But I think what the Cabinet Secretary has intimated is potential establishment of a new organisation with a new function and a new purpose.
She did announce that the SQA would be replaced.
She did.
So the reasons for that decision, is there a failure of confidence in the SQA, in terms of the ministers? Have they expressed a lack of confidence in the SQA?
Ministers have not expressed a lack of confidence in the SQA. The Cabinet Secretary on the 21st of June set out her reasoning behind the announcement that was made, aligned to the publication of the OECD review. And obviously you may wish to ask the Cabinet Secretary further questions on this matter when she appears before the committee next week. But as far as the conversations that I've had with the Cabinet Secretary and the announcements that the Cabinet Secretary has made, those are the reasons that I've outlined to you in my answer.
OK, and just before I move on to Cocab Stewart, the Deputy Convener of the Committee, how would you describe the role of the SQA in 2021 in relation to what the SQA did? Because effectively, teachers' assessments were taken as read. I mean, there was some quality assurance work that went on, and we're going to come back to that. But what, in functional terms, did the SQA do after the announcements of October and December last year?
Yeah. So in terms of the responsibilities that we have as an awarding organisation and as set out in the 1996 Education Act, our responsibilities were in principle unchanged, that we were responsible for devising and awarding qualifications. And obviously, we were in a set of extraordinary circumstances for a second year. We made a commitment, and I spoke to the predecessor committee about this in March this year. We made a commitment to work with the whole system this year to develop an alternative certification model which would fulfil our statutory functions, but most importantly, deliver for learners, to ensure that learners could be certificated and learners could continue with their learning or progress with their next steps in learning, or indeed their careers. So our focus was ensuring that we did that and working with the system to do that. Now, of course, the committee is understandably interested in national qualifications, and that's a very important part of what we do. But we're also responsible for delivering many thousands of other qualifications in relation to the college sector, to training providers, for apprenticeships, for foundation apprenticeships. So the reach of the work that we do in delivering qualifications to learners across Scotland, including young people at school, but not exclusively young people at school, was important that we took that work forward. We're also responsible for regulating qualifications provided by other awarding bodies as well. So I hope you don't mind me spending a moment just highlighting the breadth of our responsibilities. But with particular... a particular focus, as I know that the committee is keen to establish, on the alternative certification model. What we did at the start of the year was we consulted on modifications to assessment, because we knew that there was likely to be some disruption to learning in the coming year. So we undertook a public consultation around those modifications. And that was across the 150 courses across, National 5, Higher and Advanced Higher. And my colleague Jill Stewart led that work, and would be very happy to talk further about those modifications. So those modifications were announced early in the academic year. We then formed the National Qualifications Group to help advise us and to develop the approach to our work. Now, bearing in mind this time last year, Plan A was exams, so we were looking at a set of contingencies, not an alternative certification model as Plan A. Scottish ministers, the Deputy First Minister, cancelled National 5 on the 8th of October and Higher and Advanced Higher in December. So there was a lot of work during that time to develop an alternative certification model, first for National 5 and then subsequently for Higher and Advanced Higher. And in tandem provide advice on the assessment approach for each of the courses that were available, to provide understanding standards events and also, as you've highlighted, undertake quality assurance. So setting the framework for assessment for the year ahead.
So, I know that other colleagues are going to come in on this issue, so I'd like to move on now. Thank you for your answer so far. Coca.
Thank you, and welcome. I know, as a previous educator myself, that it was extremely challenging times for all of those in education, and literally had to turn on a sixpence, so I really do get that, and I want to put that on record. Looking back on, as a reflective, in a reflective mode, I'd be interested to hear from all of you, what are your main reflections on the past couple of years? And what lessons do you think that we could learn from that, or what lessons have you learned in your professional capacities?
I think that's a very important question. I mean, I think, you know, obviously we've all been in the midst of a global pandemic, which has affected every part of our lives, and I think has been felt very acutely in education, and the impacts have been felt very acutely by young people in particular. In education, so you know, I think all public organisations have faced a very challenging set of circumstances, and the tradition of a spring diet of exams, which was in place for, I think, uninterrupted for 130 years, was interrupted in 2020 with the cancellation of exams a matter of weeks before they were due to take place, and with schools closing, obviously, at very short notice. So, you know, as I highlighted in my opening statement, there was no script, there wasn't a model sitting on the shelf waiting to be activated, if you like. So I think we've been very conscious of the impact that the last 18 months has had on young people in particular, on their learning and teaching, and therefore how that impacts on their assessment, and from the perspective of the SQA, how that's impacted on their ability to undertake assessment and achieve qualifications. And we've been very focused on ensuring that young people can continue to progress in their learning, working with partners and also from our perspective to achieve their qualifications. And looking at, you know, in particular around lessons, and in particular in relation to 2021, which is the focus of this morning, you know, I think obviously that the move to remote learning after Christmas and that becoming an extended period did put a lot of pressure on young people and on schools and colleges. And so the assessment window, and I think the National Qualifications Group absolutely acknowledged that, I would acknowledge that the assessment window was quite constrained. So that was a very challenging, busy a period with perhaps more pressure on young people and on the system than we would have liked. So I think there's lots of learning to take to 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 uh, to take on board. But in particular this year, in relation to the ACM, I think that particular compressed period post-Easter. And what we've sought to do in the arrangements that we have for this year is we've sought to learn from that and to put in place very clear contingencies around disruption to learning and communicate that to the system as quickly as possible.
Dr. Jill, would you like to add anything, Beth? Would you like to?
Yes, please. Just to add to what Fiona said, I think there were some key communication things that emerged from the 2021 experience, particularly from speaking to young people, that they wanted to know what the sort of plan A and the kind of the contingencies were right up front. So that we have done as a system, and we will continue to do that. And that was very important for them to know, you know, what's ahead of me. I think there are other kind of more far-reaching lessons for the education system as a whole around about how we develop our remote learning and teaching, not as a substitute for face-to-face learning, but as an additional kind of strengthening of learning and teaching. But similarly, around assessment, we need to invest both kind of centrally in SQA and its successor body, but also locally in technology to kind of e-enable assessment so that we do kind of future-proof ourselves against things like a pandemic or another type of scenario. I think another reflection would be around the co-creation, that has been a kind of a journey and not an easy one, because everybody comes to that table with different perspectives, quite rightly, and that's what co-creation is about. But inevitably, it requires compromise on everybody's part, and I think you learn to listen and to kind of really try to understand and then to try and find a way through that. But that was very challenging. We had working groups on a weekly basis and the steering group meeting weekly, helping us to develop the ACM model, and we've adopted the same approach for 2022. We also had a similar group for HN vocational qualifications with all the kind of key stakeholders from colleges, training providers, sector skills councils, the government, SDS, Skills Development Scotland and so on, to help us to make modifications to vocational qualifications. And I think we would like to see some of those modifications retained as we move forward, because it's perhaps highlighted some areas of over-assessment in our vocational qualifications.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you, and thank you for inviting us here today. Yes, just to add to a couple of points to colleagues, I take your point, Ms. Stewart, about turning on a sixpence, and I think that's something that we've learned we've got to build into our contingency planning for 2022. The ACM 21 is quite a big model. It involves a large part of the system to have to sort of change course. And so what we've set out, and that's featured into our thinking for 2022, what we've set out are a series of contingencies, which really mean that learners and teachers can focus on the business of teaching and learning with a clear course set ahead, knowing that that if exams are cancelled, there's a clear plan in mind. And if there's further significant disruption, there's also a clear plan in mind. So this shouldn't get in the way of teaching and learning. There shouldn't be a sort of dual assessment model, and there shouldn't be additional workload for teachers so that qualifications don't get in the way of teaching and learning, but they very much support teaching and learning.
Just a quick follow-up there about, we learn lessons, but the most important thing is how we then apply that reflection. Fiona, would you be able to give me sort of like a couple of examples of how those lessons and how you're going to apply them in the immediate sort of future for, the year coming, 2021-22, and then in the medium term?
Can I ask a few questions?
other questions
to ask. I'll endeavour to be brief, absolutely. I'll pick up just a couple of things, including a couple of things that my colleagues have highlighted. And I suppose I think we've already reflected a little on how the experience of 2021 has informed our approach to the coming year. So I think that's quite an important part of the development of this approach, and in particular, as Beth has highlighted, around clarity around contingencies at the start of the year, as far as that is possible, and ensuring that the assessment burden is appropriate. And I say appropriate because it's important that qualifications remain valid and credible. You know, it's a serious business, but also being very cognizant of the fact that there's been disruption to learning, and we're still in an extraordinary set of circumstances with some disruption to learning evident in the system still. Jill's point about communication and engagement with young people, I think, is important as well. I think we heard through our learner panel that and other discussions with young people that they wanted to hear more directly from us. A lot of the communications is absolutely appropriately through schools and colleges with teachers, and that's very important. But they also wanted to hear directly from us. And so we endeavoured to do more of that in 2021, and we'll continue to do that in 2022, and ensuring that we strengthen our engagement with young people through this process, I think, is going to be very important to us and indeed any successor body.
Thanks. Thank you.
Willie Rennie.
You said this morning that your pupils should be proud of their achievement and have full confidence in the results. I want to know how you know that. I mean, you presented in your document in advance of the committee that the results this year can't be compared with previous years, but then go on to give confidence in the system by using those exact results. I wonder whether there's a bit of inconsistency there and why you've published those results if people shouldn't draw definitive conclusions from them.
Yeah. Well, what I said in my Chief Examining Officer's report, which is published on Results Day, I'll repeat here because I think it's quite important. I understand the point you're making because, we've had a couple of years in which the assessment approach and the approach that we've needed to take in the circumstances has been quite different. But we've all pulled together to ensure that young people get qualifications and their hard work is reflected in those qualifications. So I think it's a very important message, and it's an important collective message for Scotland that young people have worked hard, and that the 137,000 young people who got the results on the 9th of August worked hard and deserved those results. But we do see variation in attainment and the composition of attainment to an extent every year between courses and indeed over time. So every year there will be some differences in the attainment pattern for different reasons. But over the last couple of years, we've seen more movements in attainment than we would see in a normal year when exams are held. And there are a number of reasons for that. Disruption to learning would be one, and periods of remote learning. There were also modifications to assessment last year, and the absence of external assessment. So it was a different assessment approach. And the flexibility in how courses were considered and assessed by teachers and lecturers required due to the levels of disruption may also have impacted on attainment. I think it's very important that we highlight the credibility of the qualifications, because we put in place an approach that we felt was the very best approach we could in the circumstances, but we're also acknowledging that there are differences. There have been differences in the way in which young people have been assessed over the last couple of years, and that is reflected in the results. In terms of a run of data, there's a discontinuity, but those results are credible. I think it's important that I do highlight the quality assurance process that we undertook. Quality assurance is a really important part of any qualifications which are internally assessed. if you look at the college sector, quality assurance is absolutely central to the work that is done year in, year out, to assure students getting an HND in one, for example, in one institution in Scotland, can have parity with an HND in another institution in Scotland. So the quality assurance gives additional assurance, as suggested, that standards have been maintained and across Scotland. And we provided advice to schools on samples of evidence around whether the standard was being adhered to. So a range of approaches were taken, and that includes by schools and colleges themselves.
Can I on that consistency of evidence, because we've had reports from pupils but also teachers about the inconsistency of the evidence that was provided between schools but also between subjects as well. How do you know whether there was a consistency of evidence across the piece? Because, I mean, there is considerable evidence that contradicts that.
So there were some flexibilities in the way in which young people could be assessed. And that was part of the reason why, you know, exams were cancelled, because it was not safe to assess young people in the same way and at the same time in every school and college across Scotland, in the way that we have done for the last 130 years. So that was obviously a decision taken by ministers on the basis of public health advice. So therefore, the alternative certification model that needed to be put in place needed to have sufficient flexibility to recognise that disruption was being experienced in a different way in different schools and colleges across Scotland. So there needed to be flexibility in the approach, and that was agreed. However, the NQ group and SQA also agreed that the centrality of demonstrated attainment, that evidence was very important in determining what young people achieved. And we provided guidance, and Jill Stewart, my colleague, can say a little more about that, about what that would constitute.
So was that the only reason for the inconsistency? Was the impact of the pandemic? There wasn't a different application by different teachers in different schools for other reasons. It was all to do with the pandemic that there was inconsistency. Are you sure about that?
So I'd like you to explain what you mean by inconsistency.
Well,
I mean, you were talking a moment ago about the difference between the 2019 results and the 2020 results. Are you now talking about issues between institutions?
You asked teachers and schools, yes, to provide evidence of their pupils' performance, but different teachers applied that in different ways in different schools and between different subjects in this last year's set of assessments and qualifications, and you said that was to allow flexibility to cope with the impact of the pandemic. You know, particular outbreaks in schools, I would imagine, was one of them. Are you sure that's the only reason that the evidence guidance was applied in different ways in different schools?
We provided guidance that we expected schools to follow. Within that guidance, there was some flexibility. I wouldn't describe it as inconsistency. I would describe it as flexibility for the right reasons. Schools and colleges had and local authorities, and you heard from local authority representatives last week, provided advice and guidance around local quality assurance, to ensure that there was credibility to the evidence that was being produced within that flexibility. And we also undertook quality assurance across every school and college across Scotland. In addition, we undertook lots of understanding standards events so that we could provide as much assurance as possible that schools and colleges were following our guidance to ensure that the qualifications were credible.
Okay, one final question. Okay, it's to do with the moderation process. You were still looking at historical results to question individual performance or class performance.
No, we weren't.
Well, there was pressure put back on. There was feedback provided to schools using historical information.
No.
We had that from...
No, there wasn't.
Well, the directors who were before us last week acknowledged, and so did the EIS acknowledge, that historical performance in a school was used to provide feedback to...
I think you're
denying that completely.
I think you're asking me what SQA did. What SQA did is for its quality assurance process was looked at evidence that was provided to... that was requested from schools... and there was no information sought on historical attainment. We looked at the evidence in front of us, and we looked at whether that was to standard. If it was to standard, we provided that feedback. If it was not to standard, we provided that feedback. In addition, for every course across Scotland, we also provided course reports, which would help in ensuring that other schools understood that guidance and were taking account of the feedback. The actions that local authorities and schools took, there was some work done by Education Scotland, by inspectors, and local authorities were very clear with schools that historical attainment could inform a conversation, but would not define results.
But this is your system that you devised together in partnership with others, where historical information was used to provide feedback. But surely that provided a cost for those schools that previously were disadvantaged and provided poorer performance. So,
SQA,
and that yeah. pressure was not there.
SQA did not.
Hold on a second, let me just conclude this bit. That pressure was not there on previously better performing schools. So, why was it appropriate, even just in an advisory or a feedback loop? Why was that ever allowed to happen? Because we surely learnt the lessons from last year. Why was that allowed?
SQA did not look at historic attainment as part of its quality assurance. And did not encourage request that schools look at historic attainment as part of its quality assurance process. Ministers asked Her Majesty's inspectors to look at the quality assurance process that was in place at a local level, and inspectors did that. Local authority representatives last week highlighted the approach that they took locally to quality assurance, and what I'm seeking to explain to you here is the guidance that we provided to schools and the work that we did, and I can assure you that historic attainment was not part of that.
Quick follow up on this from Oliver Mundell. Very quick.
Thank you, Convener. I was listening carefully to the first answer you gave to Willie Rennie, where you said that these years couldn't be compared to any other, but that you do expect some change in grade outcomes. And I just wondered, do you therefore expect grades to fall this year? Do you expect grades and passes to fall if you go back to the old system?
I think we're very mindful of the need to be fair to learners taking exams in 2022. Very few learners will have taken a spring diet of exams, given the disruption that young people have faced. We've modified course assessment to take account of disruption to learning. I think that's really important. And we will work through the detail of awarding in 2022, and that's including some discussions that are underway around
What's your expectation? Do you expect grades to return to normal?
I think it would be wrong for me to speculate about grades.
Do you not think, in fairness, learners deserve to know whether or not their grades are likely to reflect past years or the two exceptional years that you've talked about that can't be compared?
We don't grade on that basis. I think it would be very wrong for me to speculate on the precise outcomes in 2022. I think what I'm very clear about is being mindful of the disruption to learning that young people have faced, and that we are considering further the issues with respect to awarding in 2022. The modifications to assessment are not trivial. and I think they will help. They are helping and will help learners during their learning and teaching experience in this coming year.
Thank you, Fiona, and thank you, Oliver. James Dornan. Ah, we've got a sound problem with James.
Okay.
Oh, good, you're loud and clear.
Right, great. Thanks, convener. Following on from what we've just heard from my last two colleagues, I wonder if you could just clarify us, because obviously it was a unique year, but how did the SQA assure that that year's results were consistent across the country? You've talked about it, but not really in any detail about how you can make sure that the results were consistent, because we've heard from Willie Rennie and others that the local authorities and schools were doing it in slightly different ways. So how could you make sure that these results were consistent?
So I appreciate I may be repeating myself a little bit, but I'll do so in order to endeavour to answer the question the best way I can. I think what we did in developing the alternative certification model is we set out clear roles and responsibilities across the system, including SQA, but also including schools, colleges, local authorities and others. And that was quite an important part, because I think we were acknowledging that everyone, in order to make this work, everyone needed to play their part in ensuring that young people got their awards in August. We also set, I think in broad terms, we set the framework for assessment in 2021. And that involved some modifications which we hoped would help young people and ensure that teachers could focus on learning and teaching. And those were undertaken across all subjects. And there were obviously particular challenges for some of the practical subjects. And again, we can talk about that if you wish in more detail. There was also a big focus on understanding standards, and because with effectively a system of teacher-assessed grades, I acknowledge that teacher-assessed grades is effectively moving from a system in which every young person is taking the same exam on the same day, and it's all being marked by SQA with lots of processes and procedures around that. We're moving from quite a centralised system to a system in which individual teachers and schools and colleges were making those determinations with some guidance from us. So therefore, all the support that we could put in place was really important. So lots of understanding standards, events, materials, building on what is quite a significant catalogue of guidance and support already in place. We provided guidance on providing estimates. So we provided guidance to schools on how that could be done, and which we received good feedback on. And we also worked with and discussed with schools and local authorities about how some of their local quality assurance was being undertaken, and I mentioned the Education Scotland report that was published, that was commissioned by ministers. But also, importantly, we undertook national quality assurance as well. And I'll maybe get Jill Stewart to say a little bit more about that, because I think that is quite an important part of that assurance process. And that involved every school in Scotland and involved a sample of evidence from a number of different courses to look to see whether the evidence was appropriate and was to standard. And we would provide feedback both to those individual institutions and those individual courses, and we would also provide some national reports to schools around that quality assurance process. So we were doing, I would acknowledge that there are some challenges around some of that, given the extraordinary circumstances we were facing. But I want to, you know, provide assurance, assurance here that everyone, and you heard from local authorities last week, and all the teachers we spoke to, and all the work that we did during the course of the year, everyone was focused on making sure that young people got the qualifications they deserved. And I think all parts of the system were working together in the best way that they could, albeit in very challenging circumstances, and albeit, as Larry said, in the context of sometimes quite challenging conversations, to ensure that we got this absolutely over the line. But Jill, would it be helpful for my colleague to say a little bit more about quality assurance? Because I think that's a big part of that, of the assurance process. Jill.
Thanks, Fiona. Just to add then to what Fiona said, we have a very strong programme of understanding standards. So we have lots of materials for each individual course where we exemplify what a performance at a C grade is or an A grade. And we have done lots of CPD, obviously online, with teachers around about that material and exploring it with them. We also have lots of online materials that teachers accessed in their own time to clarify the standards. So that's a big plank of kind of how we maintain standards. Also at a local level, very, very positive feedback from local authorities about one of the kind of positive spin-offs of the ACM model was about how it had helped strengthen their subject networks at a local authority level and the strong role that those subject networks had played at a local authority level. You know, that's particularly challenging if you're in a one-person department. You need to have a colleague to discuss the standard and get some reassurance, really, about what the standard is. So local assurance at a local level. And then SQA carried out over a kind of short window working with teachers, national quality assurance. And what we were doing there was we weren't assessing individual pupils. We were looking at the centre's application of national standard from a sample of evidence that they sent us. So we sampled every centre and the number of courses that we sampled from varied according to the number of courses that that centre offered. So if it was a, you know, lots of centres, they might have had up to 6 selections, and a lower number might have been 2 or 3 selections. What we did was we were looking to see had that centre for higher biology applied the correct standard and making their judgments, and then we provided feedback to each centre on the evidence that they'd submitted. And it was supportive feedback. It wasn't, we weren't saying to them, you know, you've got to amend your grades. It was, in the main, I suppose the headline kind of figures were that centres were applying national standards. There weren't a lot of centres that were kind of not applying national standards. Some were maybe a little bit off in some particular aspects, and we provided supportive feedback that they could use locally within their centre to have a look at that and to just have some conversations within their centres. So it is, in an ACM model, it's a distributed set of roles and responsibilities for quality assurance. SQA's role is to provide very clear guidance about the nature of assessment for each subject. So in modern languages, we assess speaking, writing, speaking, listening, reading and writing. You know, in maths, it's about how you can integrate all your skills and apply kind of operational mathematical processes and carry out reasoning across the course. In English, you know, it's about looking at candidates' writing through a folio of writing that's generated within the centre, and assessing lots of different things. In PE, it's about performance as well as an understanding of how you improve performance.
Yeah, there's a whole wide range of things that you look at, right? Okay, that's very, very helpful. I just wonder, and I'm not sure if this is for you or Fiona, but what role SQA played in the overall quality assurance process?
So, So we supported the centres through the provision of guidance for each subject, through our understanding standards materials for each subject to exemplify the standard and CPD. We provided assessment resources as well that centres could use if they wished. So we answered centre and local authority queries relating to kind of individual subjects and so on. So we were supporting the local processes of assessment and local and regional quality assurance. But then SQA's key role at the end of that process was to carry out national quality assurance and to look at samples of evidence across a small number of courses and provide feedback to the centre about their application of the national standard. And it was that feedback. It's teachers that do that. It's teachers from schools and colleges that were carrying out this quality assurance on behalf of SQA, and we were very mindful about the need to provide very crisp and clear feedback to centres, very supportive if there were any issues, and there weren't a lot of issues that were picked up during that process. So that was SQA's kind of primary role there. Upfront guidance, support, ongoing through the process, and then the national quality assurance exercise at the end to provide feedback to centres on their local application of national standards.
I wonder if I can ask Fiona Robertson, just basically on that same question. I mean, what role would SQA have in feeding into what the quality assurance programme was going to look like?
So, if I've understood your question correctly, I mean, it was for SQA to determine what the National Quality Assurance Programme looked like. I think this year we were mindful of the circumstances. You know, you have choices around the extent of quality assurance and how you do it. I think we felt that it was important to cover every school and college, so every provider, a variety. You know, we had good coverage across all courses, but we were also mindful, you know, relating to a previous answer, also very mindful of the fact that schools had been in remote learning until Easter, so we had a small window, and so it was proportionate, and it reflected the circumstances that we were facing. So, you know, there were choices, and we made choices that fit the circumstances of last year. I think that's quite important. And it was important that we did that because, you know, we get feedback sometimes that quality assurance can create create workload issues for teachers, and we didn't want to create undue stress in schools. But we also had to do our job, which was providing the very assurance that actually members of this committee have been seeking. The quality assurance piece was actually pretty important.
Okay, I've been a member of this committee before, and I've not always been kind to the SQA, but I'm not really sure that there was an awful lot more that they could do in the circumstances that was thrust on them on this occasion. Anyway, thank you very much.
Well, thank you, James. I just wanted to quick follow up because I was a bit confused with what the conversation you had with Willie Rennie earlier, Fiona. Has it ever been part of the guidance of the SQA in relation to the use of historical data?
Well, I think it's quite important that there's not confusion about the role that historical attainment data might provide.
Was it part of the guidance in the past? Was it part of the process, part of the system in the past to use historical data?
There is nothing to prevent schools or colleges considering data in informing the evidence that they look at. But I think if I'm right, and it's important that I do get this right, because I don't want there to be confusion on this issue. I think what Mr. Rennie was asking was, did historic attainment in 2021 inform any moderation or any changes to grades? And the answer is no. The answer is no from the perspective of the SQA.
In previous years, yes, but in 2021, we weren't looking at
historic attainment when we were deciding what quality assurance we undertook. That wasn't part of the approach.
Willie Rennie.
You said from the perspective of the SQA, it didn't have a role. But clearly in the system, historical data did have a role. If a question was asked that a pupil or a class was out of line with previous performance, a question was asked. Even if it didn't lead from you to a change in a result, it put pressure on the teacher or the class or the school to question whether the result was right. That never applied to better performing schools where, per se, let's say, a poorly performing pupil was never questioned because they were sticking in with historical performance. So your system, even though you never asked it and you never moderated, the system did and you allowed that to happen. So it was your system. Surely you should take responsibility for that.
Well, I don't have evidence that happened.
They said it last week. The director said it. The EIS said it. The trade unions were very clear. The questions were asked and they didn't like it being asked.
But I think the discussions that we had on a number of occasions in the NQ group, including which included the EIS, which included local authorities around this issue, was that young people, and this is very important, that learners should receive grades on the basis of the evidence in front of teachers. Now, that evidence might be subject to quality assurance. That evidence might be subject to questions from the local authority or indeed part of cross-marking. A whole range of approaches were put in place around providing assurance of the very consistency issue that you've been very keen to stress. But that results absolutely should be based on the evidence of demonstrated attainment, and that was at the centre of the approach this year.
I think it's on.
I don't know if I'm...
You're okay.
Just around this issue of historical data, to maybe put it to bed a wee bit there.
Yes.
I know that certainly, you know, there were some comments that there were small numbers of teachers that felt that they were under pressure to lower grades. Certainly that was something that was said, although it wasn't about big numbers. But my kind of understanding of this was that really, you know, when we were talking about it last week, was really that, you know, historical data was something that they would look at. But it was really more about, you know, if there was a massive difference, then that would be maybe a bit of a red flag that meant they should kind of reconsider and look at that again and just make sure they got it right. Is that correct?
I think the Education Scotland report highlighted that in some cases historical data was used in that way to ask a question or to look at, you know, to have another look at evidence. You asked local authority representatives some of those questions last week. I can only say again that I think what was very important this year and what we said time and time again was that results were based on evidence of demonstrated attainment. It was not about it was not a model in which historic attainment played a part. I think that's key. There's nothing wrong with using data to ask questions, if I may say so. Data can be very helpful to ask questions, but the decisions around grading, we were very clear throughout the year, and all partners were very clear that decisions around grading were around evidence of demonstrated attainment, and the evidence was important. And a lot of the work that we did was to try and ensure broad consistency of the evidence as far as possible in what was obviously an extraordinary set of circumstances.
Oliver Mundell and then Michael Mara.
Thank you, Convener. You said that you'd read the Education Scotland report, which I would have expected you to do. But what did you actually do in practice when you read the line, local authority officers expect staff to use these tools to review concordance data, including young people's prior attainment, and identify and address any unexpected provisional grades? Because that doesn't fit with what you're saying today. Did you read that report and think something was going wrong?
Well, I think that extract needs to be looked at in the context of the wider report. I mean, my reading of the report, and I'll acknowledge, that report has obviously been out for a number of months, was that it was highlighting the range of strategies that local authorities.
This says most local authorities, and it specifies within the report that means, I think, 70 to 90% of local authorities were using 3 to 5 year historical data, and that local authority officers expected those staff to use that to identify and address unexpected grids. That doesn't fit with the picture you're giving. And as a person responsible for the qualifications that are handed out, did you not have a problem with that at the time?
We were very clear, and we did have some discussions about this as part of the NQ group, including the report. And indeed, ADES representatives were also clear that data was being used to ask questions, to look at the emerging picture, but evidence of demonstrated attainment for individual young people was the basis on which awarding was made.
But you said nothing publicly. You didn't raise any concerns, despite concerns that were being voiced in the Parliament. You were happy to let this report from HMIE, from the government's other main education agency, sit there in the public domain and give the impression to young people that previous data from their school might be used to identify unexpected grades and address them. You were happy to just let that sit there and say nothing about it.
I think in the discussions that we had in the NQ group and the communications that we issued, we were very clear about the awarding approach in 2021 and consistent in our position, and a position that I've been very clear about this morning.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Robson. I mean, the consequences of this to me seem pretty clear. So the attainment gap between the richest and poorest increased. The performance gap between state and private schools increased. The gap between disabled and non-disabled students increased. Do you not feel that that's a consequence of this issue that we've just been discussing?
Well, I mean, the attainment gap in Scottish education is long-standing.
But increased this year under this model.
Well, there's been... Are you saying compared to 2020 or compared to 2019? It's a different picture depending on which year you choose.
So, yeah, compared to the previous year, in terms of because the changes you made as the leader of the organisation over that year to put in place this new model, and we've been discussing this issue about using the evidence in terms of previous attainment, putting it into the model as was used in local authorities, as Mr Mundell's just pointed out. This surely is the consequence of that, the suppression of those grades.
No, I wouldn't accept that characterisation. I mean, I think the attainment. I mean, I think I've made it clear the position with respect to historical attainment. That first of all, and I've made it clear the position in explaining what the ACM was and also what the ACM was not. But the issue with respect to the attainment gap. I mean, I think we obviously have a responsibility to report. On their gaps in attainment, and we have done that this year, and alongside other equalities information that we've undertaken during this process. So there was an equalities impact assessment was undertaken for the alternative certification model, and for the modifications to assessment that took place. So I think what we have a responsibility to do is to ensure that the assessment approach is not exacerbating gaps that exist in Scottish education. But attainment gaps have existed in Scottish education for a long time for lots of different reasons. The attainment gap this year did widen slightly across different groups, but the picture, as I've highlighted in 2020 and 2021, is quite different to how it looked in 2019, where the gaps were actually much wider.
We're interested in this model, though, and how it was applied. And I think that's what colleagues are getting at. And you know, it's pretty clear from the data that those gaps increased. So how do you account for that? Between the two models, the 2020 and the 2021?
Well, I've highlighted that there were differences. There have been differences in the assessment approach in 2020 and 2021. There have been differences in the experience of learning and teaching in both those years. I think that's crucial in all of this. I mean, the Scottish Government's own equality audit highlighted issues with respect, in particular, with respect to deprived young people and their experience of learning and teaching in 2020 and 2021. I think that is an avenue that this committee should explore, because the learning and teaching experience is the most important element in determining what young people can achieve in school. So I think that, you know,
I think that's fair, Dr. Rosen. Final point, if it's okay, Kavir, on this. So you're saying that the data applied had no role in this, and increase that gap had no role.
What I'm saying is that that every part of the system this year worked together to ensure that the alternative certification model was based on demonstrated attainment, evidence of demonstrated attainment for each and every learner, that was the basis on which they received their awards, and every part of the system sought to ensure.
I think, to be fair, you've said that several times now. So yeah. I think we move on to Oliver. Take the evidence forward.
Hi, thank you, convener. I just wanted to return to the convener's original line of questioning and just quickly ask the question in a slightly different way. Do you think that the OECD's recommendations in relation to assessment are right? Do you think the recommendations they've made are the right ones? From your professional experience over the years, you know, and from your experience at the SQA, do you think that the changes they identify are the ones we should follow as a parliament?
So there are two OECD reports. The first OECD report did not have a specific focus on assessment, although highlighted issues around the alignment of the curriculum and assessment issues. And we published our submission to the OECD, which documented the journey of reforms to qualifications, in particular through the development of Curriculum for Excellence. The Scottish Government commissioned Professor Gordon Stobart to undertake an additional report, which was published a few weeks ago, with respect to assessment and qualifications. And that was really a comparative study, which was looking at different countries and looking at what he called the British tradition of exams, so highlighting the fact that Scotland and indeed other parts of the UK have a tradition and a culture of exams. And I think an important part of what Gordon said and what I do agree with is that assessment and qualification approaches are effectively a kind of cultural phenomenon. They reflect the culture and practice and capacity of the system. So in thinking about any further changes to assessment and qualifications, I think it's important that we also highlight those wider issues around change.
But you think the initial recommendation effectively to move the exam or assessment part of our system in with the curriculum bit is the right decision? You would.
So are you talking about organisational change, or are you talking about changes to assessment and qualifications, or both?
I'm firstly talking about the first OECD report that suggested that the SQA or an equivalent body should be merged in with the curriculum body. Do you think, in your experience, that would be a good move?
Well, I mean, I think ministers have set out their position with respect.
I'm not asking about ministers. I was asking about your professional experience, having headed up Scotland's exam body. You know, if anyone's going to stand up for exams, if anyone's going to make the case that what we're doing at the moment is right, it would probably be you. You know, is there another side to the story that the Parliament should think about, or do you think that those recommendations are right?
I think there are issues to consider here around both function and form, and so I think the organisational structures that that exist in Scottish education are important right across Scottish education, including the national bodies. But I think it's also important in considering what the constitution and structure of those bodies is, that it's also important that we're clear about what it is we want those organisations to do. And I realise that that's quite an obvious point to make, but it's a really important one, because my observation is that we've actually reformed quite significantly Scotland's qualifications alongside the development of Curriculum for Excellence. First of all, in the 2014-16 period, in which there was a balance of continuous assessment through a unitised structure, which was continuously assessed in schools alongside exams and coursework. Following the removal of units in 2016 by Scottish ministers, we have seen a slight move back to a greater emphasis on exams. I mean, I think a lot of good systems of education have a balanced approach across continuous assessment, external assessment in the form of exams or some form of like externalised assessment, and other forms of assessment, for example, coursework. But even at the moment, and I think sometimes the debate feels sometimes quite polarised around assessment and qualifications, because at the moment, many of our courses do not rely fully on the final exam in the spring, but there are relatively small number of courses that do that. But we also need to as I highlighted in my opening statement, I mean, I think it's important to reflect on the experience of the last couple of years, and indeed some of the questions that the committee has asked today about some of your concerns about the alternative certification approach and effectively the kind of federated system of assessment considering these issues.
As a final question, convener, to just reflect on one of those issues, and it's not one I'm enthusiastic about asking about, and I absolutely believe that all young people in the last 2 years who've got the grades that they've got deserve them. But it's just to ask, you know, and obviously, you know, people are positive to see young people from more challenging backgrounds doing better than they have in the past, and you know, I would like to see that continue. But it's just whether, you know, that there are unintended consequences of grade inflation, and whether that's something, you know, you think we should be mindful of, and it's not something that's sort of popular to talk about. But it's whether, you know, it's whether that brings with it other challenges in terms of, you know, what a qualifications body should be doing, and whether I guess it comes back to the previous question I asked as well on just whether there's an expected number of A grades you would want to see in any qualification system to get that differentiation.
You know, I think I've highlighted in answer to previous questions that the pattern of attainment does look different, has looked different over the last couple of years, and there are a number of moving parts which may have contributed to that. You know, I mean, the awarding of qualifications is a serious business. You know, I mean, we have a responsibility, and indeed a statutory duty as things stand to both determine the level of competence required to gain a qualification and the means of assessing learners in order to determine whether they have. And sometimes that means, you know, well, that means that we need to be both clear about our expectations of the system, and sometimes we have to say the level of competence has not been met, and that's hard, isn't it? You know, that's hard. You know, I welcome a debate about what how important qualifications are and what they do, what the function they fulfil, both here and elsewhere, and the way in which we do that. I think that debate is to be had. I mean, some of these issues are policy issues and are issues quite rightly for Scottish Government to consider, and I'll play a full part as Chief Examiner in those discussions. And I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary will want to talk more about that next
obviously
week.
Obviously, in 2020, you pushed to have the kind of algorithmic element to keep grades, you know, where they would be expected to be. So is that something you think is important in the system?
Just a short answer to this question, so we can move on.
Standards are important, you know, and it's part of the responsibilities that we have, because the qualifications that young people get, both at the time and over time, remain important. You know, all of us will have been through that, and at different periods in our life, our qualifications remain important in terms of what happens next. And that's why when we were asked to maintain standards and develop an alternative certification model in 2020, that's why we did what we did. We were commissioned to do that, and we did that to the best of our ability. So I think we do have a responsibility to maintain standards over time. But in addition, we've been through a pandemic. We've had to put in place very different arrangements. We've worked very hard to do that in the best way that we can, and I'm really glad that you've acknowledged that young people got the qualifications they deserved, because I think it's really important that we all get behind young people to do that and to say
on our united support for our young people. There is no division at all.
I'm glad to hear it.
But on the OECD report, I think maybe Fergus, did you want to come in on this?
Yes, thank you, Convener, and welcome to our witnesses. And could I just say that no country in the world suffering the global pandemic had a syllabus ready and waiting to instruct us about how to proceed when schools were disrupted and shut down. So hindsight is a marvellous thing, is it not? But I would like to look forward, not back, and really ask two questions, the first arising from the OECD report. And I'm sure Fiona Robertson and our colleagues have read the evidence, and I was struck by the very positive comments made, for example, by Beatrice Potts, who said Scotland was amongst the leading countries in global competency proficiency. Scotland is above average across OECD countries in terms of equity. And they saw the CFE, which I want to question Fiona about, as a pioneer amongst education systems internationally. So there was lots of positives. I think the takeaway criticism, though, for me, are the central conceptual thrust of the criticism from the OECD seemed to me to be that the competencies set under the four competencies of successful learners, confident individuals, responsible citizens, and effective contributors were competencies which, if you like, needed to be better worked and assessed in the overall system. In other words, it's not clear at the moment how we assess whether or not individual children, pupils, learners have or have not attained these competencies. That seemed to me, Fiona Robertson, to be the central tenet of the criticism. If that's correct, then how do we address that in future? What needs to be done to, if you like, take Scotland forward and make sure that in driving the CFE forward, we can do so in a way where we're able to say with confidence, yes, our children are successful learners, they're confident individuals, responsible citizens, and effective contributors?
Thank you. Yeah, happy to answer those points. I mean, in relation to CFE, first of all, you know, I would agree with your sentiments and the sentiments of the OECD, and indeed the previous OECD report in 2015 also highlighted that the kind of pioneering, if you like, and innovative nature of curriculum for excellence and its endurance over time, and indeed many other countries have followed the broad approach that of curriculum for excellence, it's a very strong basis on which to build. The issue with respect to the four capacities of CFE, I mean, I think one of the emerging issues in the OECD report was that somehow the qualifications and assessment system focused on one of the four capacities, which was on successful learners, that the attainment that therefore was in one sense seen as part of quite a traditional model. And actually, if you go back to the building, the curriculum documents of Curriculum for Excellence, and I probably should highlight at the time I was the chair of the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board, so it wasn't in the role of SQA, but had a wider role with respect to Curriculum for Excellence. I mean, there was a lot of ambition in those documents about how Curriculum for Excellence would develop, including in the senior phase, including in the curriculum models that may emerge over time. And if you look at the suite of qualifications that SQA offers, I'm actually pretty confident that the four capacities of Curriculum for Excellence are covered. We provide leadership awards, mental health awards. There's a huge range of awards that we offer. I absolutely would accept that Curriculum for Excellence shouldn't simply be valued in terms of the qualifications that you leave school with. I think that's important too. It's not always what you don't always you value lots of things that you don't measure, as well as some of the things that you do. But we do offer a large suite of awards. But I think there are also issues that we need to consider as a system about the curriculum models that are followed right across the system, and that the choices that young people have, or indeed in some cases the choices that some young people don't have. And I think that there's been some really good work. In fact, there was a report just over the last couple of weeks that was published, which I would commend to the committee, on school-college partnerships and the work that's gone on there to integrate the vocational offer within schools across Scotland, and some really important lessons there about what works well and some of the perceived barriers there. So I think there's more to do in both ensuring that the offer is there, but also there are choices available to young people in schools and colleges, and curriculum. The curriculum offer is such that they can take advantage of those opportunities.
Well, thank you very much, and you've given some very good examples. And indeed, I did notice that the OECD witnesses did say that Scotland is viewed, and I quote, internationally as an example of high performance. And when we compare data with that from other countries, we see Scotland is above average in a number of indicators, especially the new OECD indicator on global competencies. So it's easy to forget all the positives in the OECD report. I just wonder, Convener, if I just might ask one more question, please, which is of a more practical nature.
Of course.
And it arose from thank you, Convener. It arose from the comments earlier that Fiona Robertson made about the importance of the need to help children prepare for examinations next year, next spring, I think Fiona Robertson said, in the background where they haven't really been used to examinations over the past 18 months or a couple of years. And, you know, I guess it's a long, long time, I think 5 decades since I sat my last examination at school, such a long time ago that, you know, the dinosaurs were prowling around the classroom cave outside, and maybe my experience is therefore a little bit dated. But I guess the essentials of exams from a children's point of view don't really change. There's the need to put work to prepare, and the inducement to work and prepare. There's the anxiety, and there's a fear factor about the unknown and the consequences. And all these, I think, are kind of constants, irrespective of the passage of time. So I guess my question is, how in practice do you think we can best equip and help prepare our learners, if that's the word we use these days, for examinations where they haven't been used to doing examinations in the recent past? And could I just put forward a particular suggestion, which may or may not be relevant these days, but is the use of sort of practice specimen papers so that children have the chance to rehearse, to practice, to try out the process of an examination before the real thing, Is that a kind of structured part of the system these days, so that, if you like, children aren't going in cold to an experience of which they're completely unfamiliar? That did seem to me, from my long-forgotten examination, preparation, to be the fundamental benefit of preparing yourself for an experience, that you had actually tried it out in peacetime before the real thing. Thank you.
Okay. I think schools and colleges are very experienced in ensuring that young people are able to prepare in the very best way they can. Many schools, including over the last couple of years, have maintained prelims or other sort of assessment. Young people are assessed across a range of on a range of things across their school life, actually, and so it's assessment as a thing is not new and will not be new to many young people. I accept that in the spring of next year, with an exam diet, that may well be new to young people. But schools will be very aware of that and will be developing approaches to make sure that that's as stress free as possible.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bring in Ross Greer.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to explore a little bit the functioning of the NQ21 group and specifically the level of participation of those involved. You'll be aware that on the day that the appeals process was confirmed, Cameron Garrett, who was the member of the Scottish Youth Parliament on the group, said, as the only young person who sits on the SQA's NQ21 group and the only member representing young people, I have not had an equal input into discussions around the appeals process this year at NQ group meetings. Young people have been let down and ignored by this process. He went on to say organisations such as the Children Young People's Commissioner's Office and SQA Wears Our Say, as well as the Scottish Youth Parliament, have been calling for no detriment policy and exceptional circumstances to be taken into consideration as substantive points. Neither have been considered in this process. Subsequent to those comments, did you reach out to Mr. Garrett to better understand why he felt that had been his experience?
Yes. And
could you talk a little bit about what you believe you've learned from those discussions and how subsequent processes to this one can more effectively involve the voices of young people?
Yeah. No, it's a very important point. I mean, Cameron has been a very, has actually been a very helpful and very good member of the NQ group, and it's been really good to see him on a weekly basis alongside colleagues from the Scottish Youth Parliament, and indeed we commissioned the Youth Parliament to deliver our learner panel this year. So there's been a variety of involvement, but of course I've had a number of discussions with Cameron and with others in SYP, and keen to both understand and also ensure that we take all appropriate steps to ensure that our engagement with young people is as good as it can be. With respect to the appeals process, I mean, I think there's probably two issues. One in terms of the operation of the NQ group more generally, and one in with respect to that particular issue, which Cameron and SYP colleagues obviously felt quite strongly about, and felt so strongly about it that Cameron said what he said. In relation to the NQ group, I think Larry Flanagan actually highlighted some of the issues. It's quite a large group, quite a lot of loud voices, and quite a lot of strongly held views. And Jill highlighted this issue of having to work through some of those complexities and come to agreement. And sometimes agreement has been quite difficult during the course of the year. And I think Larry alluded to that. And we've agreed with the Scottish Youth Parliament that we will increase the number of young people on the NQ group this year, and that's in train, because the number and variety of voices is important, isn't it? So we will do that, and that was good feedback, and we will take that on board. In relation to the appeals issue specifically, the appeals, the new appeals process, with the enactment of the UNCRC, it was important. We thought it was important that, and there was an expectation through discussions with government and, of course, the Priestley Review as well, that we would introduce a learner right of appeal this year. As you will know, previously appeals have involved young people, but have been initiated and by the school or college, and indeed the final decision about whether to institute an appeal has been through the school or college in previous years. But this year we were met with obviously a set of different circumstances in relation to the alternative certification model, but also the expectation, perfectly reasonably, that we would have a learner right of appeal. So we thought it was important that that we consulted on that. So we undertook a public consultation on the appeals process this year. There was quite a lot of discussion, and that included learner panel discussion. I attended that particular learner panel myself, in relation to appeals, and in particular, as you've highlighted, in relation to the symmetry or otherwise of the appeals process, i.e. whether appeals could result in an upgrade, or indeed in potentially a downgrade, as well as a grade remaining the same, or whether there was an asymmetry, i.e. only up or the same. In addition, there were issues with respect to exceptional circumstances, which I'm happy to go into if you wish, in relation to that. Now, we had lots of discussions about that, that obviously went through our governance as part of SQA to our board, through our qualifications committee. So it went through, there were lots of discussions, and there were lots of discussions with the Scottish Government around these issues. We decided that appeals should be symmetric, i.e. could, in principle, go up or down, or indeed remain the same. And obviously that was not a position that was supported by SYP and by Cameron on the panel. But what I was very keen to highlight to Cameron was that we took the feedback from young people very, very seriously. There were lots of discussions about that, both with them and more widely. But we took the decision actually on the basis of fairness, and that this was an evidence-based process, and that if we saw evidence that an award had been given incorrectly as a result of an appeal, that we needed to take action to do that. And it was on that basis that we took that decision. But it was a very considered decision.
Sorry to jump in at that point, but just on appeals, the specifics of the appeals process isn't particularly what I'd like to pursue with this line of questioning, but just given that you raised it, and obviously we've had exchanges about this in the past, there wasn't a particularly large number of appeals this year. Did any of those appeals result in a downgrade?
The appeals process is not yet concluded. I'm not, and indeed we will produce, I think it's official statistics at the end of the year on appeals outcomes. So I can't share the outcomes of the appeals process because we've not concluded the outcomes of that process. I'm happy to share that with the committee when the information is available. But what we said at the time was we've always had. There's always been a symmetric appeals process in Scotland, and indeed in other parts of the UK there is as well, including this year. Downgrades are very rare. They don't happen very often for all the right reasons, because most of the time the system gets it right first time. I think our approach was to ensure that we got it right first time, but there needed to be an appeals process in place because that was an important final part of this of the process. But I'm happy to provide further information on the outcomes of the appeals process when I'm able to do so.
Thank you. On a similar vein, the Children's Commissioner's Office, in fact, the Commissioner himself had some words to say about the concept of co-production, and Dr. Stewart, you mentioned that earlier on has been an area of learning from the process over the last year. The Commissioner's comments were pretty scathing. It was at the same point that Cameron made his. So Bruce Adamson, the Children's Commissioner, said some very strange examples of co-production are being discussed at the moment. If you have very limited involvement of young people and then ignore their views, you can't call it co-production just because they were in the room. So similar to what I asked in regards to Cameron, have you met with the Commissioner subsequent to those comments to discuss the concerns he had around the concept of co-production?
No, I haven't personally, no.
So could I explore that in a little bit more detail then? When you mentioned learning around co-production earlier on, Dr. Stewart, what did you mean by that? And is this taking into account the concerns that not just Children's Commissioner, but a range of other experts in the field of children's rights have raised about the concept of co-production and participation?
I think it's an area that we're all learning about how best to do, to support the work of the NQ 2022 group, and we have a working group as well. We've supplemented, as Fiona said, additional members on the steering group, but also on the working group. But we're also looking to expand the learners panel and include a wider range of young people on it. And I think it's only by engaging throughout the process that we will kind of improve and learn about the whole process of co-production and how best to do it. Do I have any kind of magic answers, Mr. Greer? No, I don't. But what we're trying to do is to increase the level of learner engagement and to be very active listening mode as to how best we might do that. I mean, this is a sort of reflection from a different piece of work, but we did some work with young people about the future of assessment prior to the kind of current COVID situation. And I think it was very interesting because it was work where we involved young people along with some teachers, and young people had very different ideas about assessment from their teachers. And what you saw there was a bit of a kind of... It was co-production in that sense, in that young people made suggestions, and then teachers, didn't poo-poo those, but they pointed out some of the practical difficulties, and they reached kind of different conclusions, about how you should best assess in particular subjects. The one that struck in my head was about history, and teachers often want to assess the way they've always assessed because they know how to help young people do that, whereas young people come at it from the perspective of, well, I would like more of my work to be taken into account on a kind of ongoing basis that I'm producing throughout the year. So to me, co-production is about, in the future of assessment sphere, it's about how you get those two sets of people together in the kind of co-construction of what the future of assessment should be in different subjects. And I use that just as an example, but it's challenging because it's the young person doesn't necessarily have the precise answer and the teacher doesn't necessarily have the precise answer, but it's by bringing people together and getting them to actively listen to each other that you can come up with kind of ways forward. And I think these are the sorts of learning experiences that we need to use to inform, for example, the future of assessment.
I understand entirely that there's no easy answer to that. Given the comments of the Children's Commissioner, though, I would expect you to engage with his office to understand those concerns and with others such as, I know Dr. Tracy Kirk has engaged with you on these issues.
There has been engagement. I mean, there has been engagement and correspondence with the Children's Commissioner. I'm very happy, very happy to continue to do that. But I think what Jill's highlighted is really important is to seek to understand the different perspectives and the different responsibilities that we have. I highlighted at the start that, the awarding of qualifications is a serious set of responsibilities. You know, I've got statutory responsibilities to fulfil, statutory functions to fulfil, and therefore, it's really important that we engage in these conversations to seek to understand, to reflect. But it's also our job to ensure that we're fulfilling our responsibilities as an awarding body, and sometimes that means, unfortunately, and I say this with some regret, unfortunately that sometimes means that we're not able to do all the things that everyone wants.
I accept that. I'm conscious of time, and I'm probably intruding on other members' time at this point. If I can come back in at the end, that'd be appreciated. But I understand.
That's very generous. We'll take you up on that, Ross, because I'm going to turn now to Michael Mara.
Thanks, Convener. I'm interested, I suppose, in some of the questions about form and function, as you put it. And we all know that the very important job the SQA has to do over the coming year, and the pandemic challenges remain vast, I think, for the education system. So on the 21st of June, Dr. Robson, you issued a statement welcoming the announcement that your organisation was going to be scrapped. So did you consult the SQA staff before issuing that statement?
I didn't use the word scrapped. I think it's quite important. I highlighted the announcement that the Cabinet Secretary had made.
The announcement of a new specialist agency with responsibility for both curriculum and assessment, this is an opportunity for significant change.
Yes, I did say that. Yeah. But I think it's important to be accurate in what I said, so I appreciate you repeating that. I had a meeting with all staff on the morning of the announcement, but the statement was in my name, and obviously had discussions with the board and with all staff on the morning of the announcement, and it was very important that I did that.
And there's some significant upset amongst staff. I mean, I've spoken with trade unions who have said that they're both upset in terms of the announcement and the way that it was welcomed by the leadership of the organisation. Is it fair to say?
I think I have good ongoing engagement with colleagues across SQA and our two recognised trade unions. I think it's important for us to. I've highlighted it in my opening statement, and I've also highlighted this to staff that I think it's important that we engage positively with this review process. I think there are always, for every organisation, you've highlighted in your questioning today more broadly, the learning and the reflection and the need for some change. I think I think it's important that we as an organisation, along with other organisations in Scottish education, reflect on that need for change. I would wish to highlight very strongly in answer to your question the commitment, professionalism, integrity of staff, every member of staff in the SQA, in the face of quite a challenging period and quite a lot of political comment, which has in my view been at times unacceptable.
Okay.
Because we have a set of responsibilities to fulfil. We have had a clear commission from government to undertake tasks, and we have done those to the best of our ability. When people like yourself say scrapped, abolished, and other adjectives, yes, you will get a reaction from staff. You'll get a reaction from me as well, because there's a lot of skill and there's a lot of expertise in the SQA that Scotland needs, Scotland will need in the future.
Yeah. I think it's really important
that I highlight that to the committee this morning.
I think it is really important, and I welcome you putting that on record. And I know that there's, having spoken to the trade unions in the SQA, you know, that there's was real concern in terms of the way that happened. I mean, I'm interested in part of this, the relationship between leadership and expertise as we talk about this. And so for the model for 2020, Did staff make representations to you telling you that that would be, in their words, the disaster that it turned out to be?
I think during the 2020 process, within the SQA, we had a number of conversations across a range of issues in which we were considering some of the challenges of awarding in 2020. There's no doubt about that. It was a very challenging period. My colleague Jill Stewart led the process of the approach in 2020, and I think she would confirm that, you know, it was a challenging period which we were very concerned to deliver on the commission from ministers and to get it right, actually. That was our concern. But so there were a range of conversations that we had around that and around our concern to get it right.
Okay, I appreciate that. And I suppose, given some of the previous questioning, I'm a little bit worried, I suppose, in terms about the distance from government, in terms of how independent some of that advice and the kind of the expertise that you rightly reflect is so important to the education system that can be drawn on, and the extent to which that takes place. So I want to look forward a little bit to next year, if we can, to pull this together, convener, and the plans that you've set out. So the guidance that was issued on the 15th of September, I think in my view, it really kind of contained a lack of detail and clarity, and I recognise the context that everyone is operating within. But that clarity is needed for teachers and for young people, and we have heard that very strongly through the evidence we've had from young people. Complete lack of clarity last year, even less the year before, looking for more clarity this year. So in particular, guidance sets out decisions that if mitigations to exams are needed, that will be left until March of next year. It doesn't set out whether any detail of what criteria those decisions are going to be made on. Any comment on that would be useful. Whether that will be pupil by pupil, school by school, council by council, or Scotland-wide. So are we going to get, what level is that approach going to be decided on? And, you know, will disruption be experienced differently by all pupils? And so we really need more clarity on that. Could you give us some comment?
Yes,
and add some clarity for those young people.
That's right. I mean, first of all, I totally understand the need for clarity, and I understand that. And you know, I think, you know, looking back on 2021, and of course my appearance before the committee this morning made me look at all the communications that we issued in 2021, and I was really very struck around the fact that obviously we were dealing with a lot of change in real time, actually. So, and we were, I think, as an NQ group, generally, we were mindful of the fact that we didn't want to bombard the system with changing guidance. So things were changing every 5 minutes, but at the same time, we wanted to provide as much clarity as possible. And there's actually quite a tricky balance around that, about how much you provide, when you provide, because we, you know, and being seen to, you know, I don't think any of us wanted to be seen to be chopping and changing in seeking to provide clarity. Mm-hmm. So I think there's something quite important in there about what is the right balance around all of that. In terms of clarity, you know, as things stand, you know, Scotland is, I think the only part of the UK which has been clear on arrangements for 2022. Mm-hmm. We've come out quite early. I think there's a context there that is quite important, that we've set out the contingency arrangements that will be in place for 2022. I would the contingencies relate, and my colleague Beth Black would be happy to talk about this in a bit more detail, but the contingencies relate largely to national contingencies. We would expect if exams are to be held and as appropriate, exceptional circumstances would apply for in circumstances where there was very significant issues that would impact on performance for young people at the time of an exam. And that happens every year. So in some cases, that's highly individualised, it's a bereavement or an illness. In some cases, it's a little broader than that. So, for example, if schools have suffered from we've had in recent years school closures for different reasons or fire, you know there's been fired and other things that have happened to schools and exceptional circumstances has kicked in there, and we've discussed with schools changes to deadlines and other arrangements that can take place. So we do have flexibility to ensure that if circumstances apply locally or individually, that measures can be put in place to mitigate the impacts around all of that. In relation to the contingencies, in broad terms, I think what we're saying is if there's very significant disruption to learning or further disruption to learning, and that would be beyond that experienced in the 2020-21 academic year, and we need to take advice from the Education Recovery Group and Public Health on that. So there's a context there that's important, and indeed that the Scottish Government consider further modifications. And exams would only be cancelled, and this is a further contingency, if public health advice in the spring was such that they could not be held for public, i.e. gatherings of young people. I would appreciate that clarity from Beth.
On one point just within that, if I can, Convener.
Cool, because there are some other questions on this line.
Yeah, so just within yes. that, we are now, in recent weeks, have been at a level of absences in schools that were equivalent to when we cancelled exams previously last year. So do you have concerns or reflections as to lost learning and where we might be at the moment? I don't mean to be alarmist in this at all, but I think in terms of the decision-making process, it's appropriate that we consider that. Do you think?
I think the focus, obviously, at the moment is not on assessment, it's on learning and teaching at this point in the year. That's really important. And, you know, schools and colleges will have responsibility for ensuring continuity of learning and teaching, even if there is some issues around absence levels. So I think we're very aware of that. But the focus at this point in the year is absolutely on learning and teaching rather than assessment. But Beth can highlight some of the measures that we could put in place should that be necessary. But keep in mind, we've made modifications to assessment so that learning and teaching time can be maximised, and that those modifications are in anticipation that there will be disruption to learning this year. So I think we've taken that step up front, and we've reduced the assessment burden so that it should be more straightforward for young people, and should allow for a degree of disruption should that be in place. Beth.
Beth, Michael, do you mind if I bring in Bob?
Please.
Because he I think, had a question in this area. So if we hear Bob's question, then Beth can give us a fuller answer. Bob.
Thank you. I welcome that, Convener, and it's a really helpful line of questioning that my colleague Michael Mara was exploring. Now, I know initial guidance has been issued, and we're all holding our breath what that more detailed guidance will look like, and perhaps that's what we're going to get from Beth. But I'm just looking at the guidance that we have out there. So there's three scenarios at present. There's we run with exams as planned, with modifications that Fiona Robertson's highlighted that will exist in terms of assessment. We go to an additional modified process, but with exams, or we return to some form of alternative certification model. Now, it's that, Convener, that I wanted to ask a question about. Now, a quote from the guidance: the type, quality and volume of evidence that would be needed to support quality assured estimates in a normal year. This would be used to support provisional results. And it goes on to say, provisional results would be based on in-year assessments that normally take place during the school year, such as prelims, practical activities, performances and class tests. So whilst, Convener, we have before us, in theory, three different models, two of which exams take place but modified, and one where exams don't take place, but with another form of alternative certification. But according to the guidance, these are the types of assessments and observations and evidence gathering that teachers will be doing anyway. Can I ask Fiona Robertson or Beth what the difference actually is?
Okay. Yeah, I'll Beth can cover that in the answer to Michael Mara's question.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Very slight. I hope I'll answer that. I was very slightly confused at the end about the difference. But so, yes, so modifications are already in place to acknowledge and anticipated some disruption. And as Fiona has said, these are significant, they're not trivial, and, you know, they take account of the assessment burden. And I think that means that teachers and educators can concentrate on teaching and learning, But we are keeping a watching brief on the disruption, and, you know, we're very, very aware of the disruption and the trouble that this is causing in the system, so we're keeping a watching brief on that. And if there is disruption beyond a certain point, somewhere in the region, the kind of disruption that we saw last year, then there will be some further interventions that will help learners in the support in that final period, in that run-up to exams, so that it will help take the heat out of that revision period and help support them through that. So you know, we will be keeping a watching brief, and obviously it's very difficult for us to put numbers on these things and to announce numbers, because numbers can become targets, and it's actually incredibly complicated. So it's very difficult to be entirely reductive about that, but it's definitely a watching brief. So in teaching and learning, assessment takes place naturally. So this is naturally occurring part of teaching and learning. And so rather than try and bring in at very late notice, possibly a large ACM, which would then involve all sorts of semi-formal assessments, the instruction would be, if exams had to be cancelled for public health reasons in the spring, then the normal assessment that teachers rely upon in their normal working lives will form part of the support for the provisional grade that they would submit. And in any year, teachers always submit estimates to SQA just before exams. This is an ordinary practice in any year. And so what will happen is, in any ordinary year, the estimate is being prepared, it's being ready. Teachers are mindful about how to collect that. They know how to make judgments about the evidence in front of them. We're further supporting that with the understanding standards work, which we've heard of was very, very popular. And teachers welcomed it, and it increased their capacity and capability in understanding standards. So that also feeds into this normal practice of estimates. And should we find, worst case scenario, in March or April, and we hope we don't, that public gatherings can't go ahead or large gatherings can't go ahead, then that normal activity becomes repurposed to become the provisional grade. And the advantage of this is that, and this is quite important, is it means that teachers should not worry about undertaking additional assessments to keep in their back pocket. And learners shouldn't worry about being dual assessed. And it isn't everybody's first choice. It's not the first choice to cancel exams. And it wouldn't be, so it's very much a kind of plan C, but we have to have a contingency in place. And we've listened to what the system has told us about the workload involved in the ACM. And this is part of the thinking in this plan.
I'm going to go first back to Bob for a follow-up and then to Michael Mara.
Kavina, that's very helpful. Beth had mentioned about when I said what the difference actually was. I think that's what I was trying to tease out. But what I think the SQA are saying is you'll embed the normal day-to-day practice of teaching professionals into any alternative certification model if that's where we have to end up. And that's very helpful. I'm wondering what role moderation would play within that process, because we still have in quality assurance, because we still have the same situation about one-person departments, different approaches within local authorities or different local authorities, so that would be helpful as well. And I'm not sure if I'll get back in a second time, so I'll add the second question, Cunil. I would like to explore some of this further, and that is, teachers will feel very empowered now, as they should do, that when they put in an estimate for a young person, that estimate will be a true reflection of the competencies that a young person will be operating at. Because after all, that's what they've been asked to do with moderation and quality assurance, and we then go to the exams. And as we know with any exit exam, not every young person will perform as well as anticipating those exams, and that's where the appeals process comes in. Has the SQA considered that, should the exams go ahead, and I hope they do, next year, that we can anticipate many, many, many more appeals than before? Because teachers and young people will feel empowered to have high-quality estimates showing young people operating at a very high level. If they don't perform that way in an exam, then a significant amount of appeals are likely to come forward. So has the SQA also given consideration of that?
All right. Thank you for that, Bob. Who's going to answer that?
I'm happy to start, and Beth
right.
can come
just
in.
Just mindful of the time that
is remaining. Yeah, I'll be brief if I can. On quality assurance, if we were in a position that exams could not go ahead, I think for all the reasons that we've discussed during the committee session this morning, we think some quality assurance would be an important part of the approach that we would take, keeping in mind that evidence is key, what we'd be asking teachers to do would be to ensure that that there'll be some further guidance around estimation over the next couple of weeks, to crystallise some of that, but also not create unnecessary workload, because I think we're very, very conscious of that this year. I think that will be important, and obviously all the understanding standards work that Jill has highlighted will continue to ensure that programme is developed and delivered. In relation to the appeals process, obviously the appeals process that we had this year was with respect to the approach that we took this year, absolutely learner-centric, learner-initiated. So we will be looking at the appeals process for 2022, and I would anticipate it will be a learner right of appeal for all the reasons I've highlighted, and we will be looking at the detail of that. I mean, there is an existing process, appeals process which has been in place for a number of years up to the point of 2019, which we can use, but we will be doing some further work to establish in more precise terms what that appeals process looks like. But your point about high quality estimates is important, because actually the communication between the school or the college, the teacher and the young person in setting expectations, also setting aspirations actually as well about what young people might be able to achieve is actually really important, and that's an important part of the discussion, that the good high quality discussions that go on day in, day out across Scotland in relation to how people are doing, how young people are progressing in their learning and what they're likely to achieve, either through an alternative certification model or indeed through an exam process. I think that's those are very important conversations to be had.
I'm going to ask Michael Mara to come back in and be brief, and if I can have brief responses as well, because Stephanie's been very patient, and I must get to Stephanie.
Thanks, Kavir. You talked about a watching brief, and I'm not asking for numbers, for number of days of disruption or anything along those bases. What I suppose I'm interested in particular, is if there's one school in one part of the country or one local authority that has been very significantly disrupted, and another part hasn't, could we possibly see a different approach for those different areas? So could we see exams cancelled in Glasgow but not in Edinburgh? Or we're talking about a national approach, because you, and I see lots of shaking heads. So on that basis, I mean, you talked about exceptional circumstances and taking the individual approach into account, Dr. Robertson. So how do you square those two things?
I mean, I think we would be looking at a national exams process, but the exceptional circumstances that I've highlighted to you, which has existed in previous years, and Jill might want to say a little bit more about that, but that's important, because it can apply individually, because actually it's the individuals that are important here. It applies individually for very particular reasons, but it can apply more broadly if a school or a cohort of young people have been affected in a particular way, that's important. In 2021, the whole year was about exceptional circumstances. The cancellation of exams by ministers was reflecting the exceptional circumstances across the country, and the flexibility that schools were able to deploy was effectively the way in which they could use the exceptional circumstances to ensure that young people got their qualifications.
Okay. Thank you. I think I've got clarity there, Kavira. Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks.
And can I just go back to Bob? Bob, did you want to have any follow-up? It has to be very brief, though.
Just very briefly, Convener, I'd be really interested to know whether the SQ anticipate that the appeals process in the coming year is more likely to be successful, because teaching professionals were always doing a good job in estimating grades, but through the last couple of years, we've had to set a really detailed, specific approach to evidence gathering and submission under the alternative certification model. So can we anticipate a really robust system of estimates? And if those system of estimates are high quality, should we expect much more successful appeals in the year ahead? And should young people know those estimates before they walk into their exams also?
Appreciate Bob asking. I think you asked that question before as well.
On the volume of appeals in any year, actually. But I think your point about the experience of, in particular, this past year and the feedback that we've got around a real focus on understanding standards across schools and colleges, you know, lots of discussion within departments and across subject teams and actually across schools within local authorities and indeed regional improvement collaboratives has enhanced the understanding of standards in Scotland schools. So I think that's been a good thing, and I think there's been positive feedback in relation to that. And I don't doubt in any year that teachers are absolutely doing their best to ensure that that young people are being kept very closely involved in discussions about their progress. But the feedback we've had this year is that the focus and the responsibility that teachers had in determining grades has absolutely involved quite a lot of investment and a lot of hard work and commitment in understanding standards and applying those standards appropriately.
Thank you. For the final round of questions, given the time constraints we have, I thank Stephanie for her patience. I'll hand over to her.
Thank you, Stephen. I do appreciate as well that this, you know, the past couple of years, there have been lots of really huge decisions that you've had to make, a huge amount of work in a very short period of time, and not necessarily the work that you've actually been used to doing in the past there. I'm really interested as well in what work it is that you're doing just now. It's kind of gone back a little bit to what Ross was talking about earlier. But what work are you doing just now around planning or strategies for models of co-production and giving young people's views parity, taking on board teachers' views, actually going forward and getting that real collaboration where you are able to arrive at decisions together?
Yeah. No, I think it's a good question. I mean, I've alluded to some of that work during the questioning. And I think there are a number of strands here actually around broader communications and engagement, and more generally, we have increased our capacity internally around that with the appointment of a new director of communications, and enhanced our internal capacity around particularly young people and parental engagement. I mean, communications and engagement is really important, but there will always be a variety of views about how effective or otherwise it is. I mean, I could go through in some detail all the work that we did this year to try and do that, and we did a lot of communication and engagement, and indeed bespoke communication with young people and parents that was informed by feedback from those groups. But I think we've probably, I think it's fair to say that there's a never-ending appetite for that, and we need to make sure that we're doing that in the best way that we can, and that we're mixing up the approach through social media and other things. But in relation to in engagement itself, I mean, I've highlighted that we're enhancing young people's representation on some of our groups. Including the NQ group itself, expanding the learner panel, which I think is really important, and and, you know, having a forward work programme for them, because as I say, you know, quite a lot of the work was in real time last year, and I think, you know, it felt, you know, it felt that sometimes there wasn't the lead in time to things that we would have liked. You know, I think, and indeed, you know, the review that Ken Muir is undertaking in looking at some of these issues, I think will have a big focus in terms of any successor arrangements, both to SQA and indeed the reforms to Education Scotland. I think will look very, very closely at, in particular, young people's engagement. And Jill highlighted the work that we did before the pandemic. It was both before my time, I have to say, but just before the pandemic, around Assessment Futures. So, you know, absolutely, there's some really good foundations there around some of that. And of course, some of that gets into the policy space. So the ongoing discussion and engagement with the Scottish Government around some of those issues, I think is really, really important. So I hope that's helpful as a kind of fairly high level summary of some of the work that we're doing. But we're very keen to ensure that we do take account of and that young people's views are integrated into the work that we do as far as possible. We are here to serve learners. A lot of our work absolutely is supporting the profession to serve learners, but our job is to serve learners.
And I trust the answer will be yes, but I take it that will include, including care experience, young people, additional support needs, etc. there as well. Because what we very often find is all the things that work for these pupils actually work really well for the other pupils as well there. So,
no, I mean, we actually have an annual event with Who Cares Scotland on Results Day. And, of course, the last couple of years we've had to do that virtually. But, my first year in SQA in 2019, that was attended by the First Minister herself, giving certificates to care experienced young people and reflecting on the very impressive achievements of those young people, given some of the challenges that they have faced. So, you know, short answer, absolutely, that's really important. I think I would also highlight that, you know, it's we have in place a very substantial piece around assessment arrangements for young people who, for a large number of different reasons, cannot take exams in the standard fashion. So there's a lot of work that we do to support young people to gain qualifications each year, engaging very closely with centres to make sure that any arrangements are in place, whether it's scribes or font type or what. Impressive array of assessment arrangements that we can put in place to ensure that young people are treated fairly, and we're taking account of personal circumstances in undertaking our awards.
Question for Jill, actually. You mentioned earlier on about some of the bigger lessons that you've been talking about, so around remote learning, assessment, we've talked about quite a bit. You talked about e-enabled assessment as well and the kind of co-creation part of it. I was just wondering if you could expand a little bit on things such as e-enabled assessment and the remote learning stuff that you were speaking about there. If you've got a bit more information on that just now, if that's at the very early stages, I appreciate that too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think e-assessment is very much, you know, should be part of our kind of toolbox, really, of assessment approaches. And we've started to explore, even with the existing courses, some of the practical courses, how we could turn what are effectively short question papers now into e-assessments. You know, so that's just one example of the sorts of things that we could do. But I think too, how SQA receives evidence from schools and colleges, if we could do that digitally and build an infrastructure to do that digitally and to be able to carry out all of our marking electronically and the quality assurance processes. There's a lot of coursework as well that features in national courses. So if we can find digital means, for example, for a music course, people have to perform on a number of different instruments. So in the future, you know, could we do that remotely? Similarly, art and design, there's a big portfolio of artwork and design work that young people, you know, currently have to has to be physically sent to SQA, but how could we use technology to do that digitally in a much more kind of streamlined way? And that would also open up opportunities as well to the sorts of things that could be assessed in the future as well. It might widen out the types of things that could be assessed. One of the things that comes through very strongly from young people is they would like to see more skills development. You know, so technology could be really, really helpful in that sort of area, in the assessment arena. So those are just some of the kind of things that we could explore as a system moving forward. Some of them might be shorter term, and some of them would require a kind of medium to long term kind of running to do some of those. But I think that's definitely the way that I would certainly like to see things develop.
There's a big system piece in all of this, actually, because, you know, this is a broader conversation for the wider system in terms of both the investment required and also the need for all parts of the system to have, you know, to have the appropriate digital tools in place in order for us to do that. And, you know, this has been picked up in the SFC tertiary review, particularly in the context of colleges and universities. And also there's a programme for government commitment around a National Digital Academy, which is focused in particular on learning and teaching. But there are opportunities there around assessment as well. So, you know, I think there's some potentially some really good developments in thinking around some of those issues, which could lead to the possibility of remote assessment and many of the challenges that we've discussed today. Some of them at least would fall away. But there's a broader issue there, and again, that may be something that Ken Muir will wish to pick up on in terms of the review that he's undertaking, and in particular in relation to how curriculum and assessment, both integrates and is delivered. ESCOL obviously has been a very important, you know, important development, and has been used during the pandemic for broader purposes. But, you know, so there are opportunities there, but it's a systems piece.
Okay, that's great. Thanks very much. And I did just want to say, you know, I think we didn't get everything right, and we didn't quite get the balance right in some of the areas. But it's good to know that we're in a better place this year, and that looking to the future, there's a lot of positive stuff there as well. And thank you to all of you for your commitment to actually working over the next couple of years as these changes come through. Thanks.
Thank you, Stephanie. Indeed, we are all united, as I said earlier, in the respect of caring passionately about the future of our young people, because they represent the future of our country, indeed our planet. And so these are big issues and highly politicised. I don't think anyone would deny that. This is the big stuff of politics. I want to thank our witnesses today, Fiona Robertson, Dr. Jill Stewart and Beth Black from the SQA. Very grateful for the time you've given us. We have tested your stamina. You've not been found wanting. We've kept you going for 2 hours and a quarter. That's quite a lengthy session of cross-examination. And at this point, I'd like to bring our meeting to an end. Next week's meeting on Wednesday, the 6th of October, will take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills on the Cabinet Secretary's priorities for Session 6 of the Scottish Parliament. I will now suspend the meeting and ask members to reconvene on Microsoft Teams, and this will allow us to consider our final agenda item in private. Thank you very much.